Hello everyone, you're watching Conversations with Kishani Alanki. As International Women's Day is approaching, I would like to dedicate this segment to all the women out there. Now, as women, we often face many challenges and we look up to women leaders in the hope that they would pave the way for a better future for all of us. On today's segment, I'm in conversation with Parliamentarian Dr. Sudarshani Fernandopulle. Thank you so much for saying yes and being a part of today's segment.
Thank you very much, Alanki, for giving me this opportunity.
It's a pleasure. Let's just start off with talking about your entry to politics. Prior to your entry to politics, you served as a doctor and you served in the government service for over two decades. How was your transition into politics? What was it like to be a woman entering into politics?
Of course, I was not a person who liked politics, you know, to be honest, because we were brought up in a very secluded family environment where we were made to understand that politics was tough, difficult, ugly. So, but however, I got married to my husband, who was a political activist. He was the organizer for Sri Lanka Freedom Party for Katana. At first, when this proposal came, I was a bit reluctant, but then I agreed. But he was a very nice, very loving husband. Although I was not directly involved with politics, I was in the background. You know, I used to help my husband, support him with his campaigns. But after he was assassinated in 2008, I had an invitation from the Venerable Mahasangha. My party activists, the party leaders, they invited me to enter politics, and I had no hesitation. I said yes, and I resigned from my post, which I held as the program officer for child health at the Family Health Bureau, Ministry of Health, and became the. Subsequently, I had to leave government service to contest. And I retired prematurely because I had completed a service of 24 years and then contested the 2010 April elections.
What was it like to be a woman in politics? I mean, there are 225 parliamentarians, out of which only 12 MPs are women. Do you think you have to strive in the face of adversity?
Of course, yes. I felt what discrimination was only after I entered politics. Until then, you know, as a student, as a medical student, as a doctor, you know, we used to do the same sort of work, you know, we used to work hard. But when I entered politics, I felt that the women were not being treated the same way as the men. And also the few women, now we have only 12, the 12 are compared with 230. So, right. You know, the time we get to speak is also say around 10-15 minutes. So, but there are more men out there talking, arguing, you know, fighting. And also the people, now we live in a patriarchal society, still the woman is treated as a second class citizen, especially it is so in politics. Right. You know, even the leaders think, you know, women are not very competent, because the how they define a politician, you know, it's still the same, you know, traditional way. You have to be powerful, you have to be violent, you have to be vociferous, you should have a lot of money. So within those definitions or indicators, women will not stand a chance. And also women, most of the women out there in parliament, the 12 of us, are professionals, like, you know, educated, well educated, and also we work on policies. So we are at a disadvantage because we are not powerful in the sense we are powerful, we are strong, but the way strength is measured by society is different. So definitely nature has created the man to be more powerful, I mean the muscle strength, but although when we have been created to be mothers,
absolutely,
you know, to be very sensitive, loving, to care for children, but you know, when it comes to political strength, they think a man has a better chance. And also politics is usually associated with violence, a lot of, you know, character assassination. So when it is a woman, it is very easy to put her down. So out there, it's very tough for women. But unfortunately, we have more women in the society. Of the voters, 56% are women. So if the women know their strengths, know their rights, know that they have to be represented, because we are a minority at the decision making level, if the women come forward, if they know their strengths and their rights, I think more women could be elected to parliament.
That is very empowering. What was the toughest challenge you've had to face as a woman in politics?
First election was, you know, very peaceful, because it was soon after my husband's assassination and I got around 182,000. But the majority of the votes were due to my husband, you know, the sympathy vote, and also he was also very popular, loved politician. So that was mainly attributed to him. The second election I faced was very tough, you know. I had to fight there with men, and you know, sometimes you have to fight with women also. It's very unfortunate.
Right.
Like within parties, you have women's organization, but these organizations do not do much to empower women and bring more women. They also try to work and, you know, get a man elected from, you know, from the background. So it is very unfortunate. It was very tough, you know, character assassination, you know, they try to mentally, you know, try to put you down, and also a lot of false propaganda,
right,
is sort of, you know, created. They create unwanted, say, false information. So it is contesting is very tough, because under the preferential system, it is very tough to do gentlemanly politics, because in preferential, in elections, I don't see any gentleman or lady, like, you know, it's very difficult. And not only for women, even for learned men, educated men, it is tough. So the voters, I don't know, right now the voters are looking for educated, qualified, disciplined people who have not sort of created any crime. So I think it is happening. It is that I hope the next parliamentary elections would be a turning point where the majority of elected members, whether men or women, are from some professional backgrounds or are some who can be considered as leaders, who will be role models to our future generation.
Absolutely.
So I request the public to be, you know, very cautious, to be very, you know, intelligent in voting your parliamentary member at the next election.
Absolutely. Like you mentioned, there is a huge demand for educated personalities to enter politics. But how do you define education? How educated should a candidate be?
Alanki, I am not looking at the paper qualification alone, but for whatever employment, you need the basic qualifications like O-level and A-level. It is not only the paper qualification, but, you know, intelligence and education. I think they are two different things. Knowledge, you can be knowledgeable, but not intelligent.
Yes.
So intelligence, where the people should be able to represent the problems, issues faced by the majority, and also they should be able to negotiate, bargain, rather than taking violent measures. And also they have to abide by the law. Also, you can't break the laws. Every citizen, Sri Lankan, has to abide by the Sri Lankan laws. But there are certain instances where you may have to sort of bargain to do the best for the people. So the people should be able to represent the views of the majority, and also read and understand a document, and also to give suggestions, ideas coming from the people, so that the country could be taken forward.
Right, like you said, I mean, you need a certain basic standard of education if you are to represent the people. And I personally believe that education sort of gives you a certain degree of discipline.
Definitely.
Which is obviously required if you are going to be a people's person. But there is a lot of controversy around famous people entering politics. It is believed that if you're famous or if you're a film star, you can actually break into politics easily. But how long can such a person survive in politics?
It's a question, you know, looking back at the history, so many famous personalities have not been able to remain in the system.
Right.
You know, they have been voted out, or they have withdrawn, or they have shown the people that they are not successful politicians. So, but the preferential system again gives priority to famous people, people who have money, who can spend a lot, you know, distribute things during the campaigns, so to get votes. So, I think we should, as you said, qualifications are also, education is important, because through education you learn the other skills, and also education teaches you to be disciplined.
Right.
So we need disciplined people who will not harm the society, who will not harm the systems. But you know, there are certain people who come into politics with vested interest, maybe to make it like a, what do you call, a trade. Politics, you know, is a job for somebody, or a business, or sometimes businessmen come, you know, with hidden agendas. Some people who are in illegal, some, you know, irregular, unlawful activities, they fund heavily certain candidates, so that they will, you know, once they are elected, they will back their irregular, illegal businesses. So people have to be very cautious. People have to be, you know, they will have to look at the, not only the education qualification, but do a bit of a background search of the family, how they live, the income, how the source of income, you know, the vehicles they travel in, whether they could afford to do so. So, I mean, that sort of background search would be very important, you know, if you are to get the better people into parliament. They may not be the best, but they should be the better from the lot.
Absolutely. So it depends on the people and the voters to actually vote wisely in the upcoming elections. Being a woman, you have to always multitask. You're a mother and you're also in a career which is very demanding. How do you balance both?
Of course, when since I am in active politics now, I try to give priority to my vote base, the electorate and the people's you know, demands. But at the same time, I have time for the family also, because I have two children. I had a major responsibility, because when they lost their father, they were very young. Both around 14, 15 years, right. You know, the gap was around 1 year. And I had to focus on the education. I wanted to bring them, you know, out of the trauma they went through. I love to be with my family, so I have time for my family. But again, it's very hard to, you know, this job is very demanding. Without any family support, you know, it's very difficult for a woman to survive, because although we are politicians, we are mothers.
Absolutely.
And then we are also daughters. We are also sisters. So we have other family obligations, looking after parents, looking after our old sort of siblings who are sick, and also looking after our whatever businesses or whatever sources of income. So it is tough. I have a lot of family support. You know, my mother, of course, she is sick now, but when she was strong, she was a strong, you know, she was the one who was behind me, who looked after the children, and not only my children, my sister's children, because she is also a doctor. And then she used to manage the household for me. So I'm very thankful and grateful to my mother, and my children are adults now. They are very supportive. They are very understanding, you know. So because of the family understanding and support, I am able to manage. And I also have a very good, I have only a sister who is married to my husband's, late husband's brother.
All right.
So it's like same family. And my in-laws also very supportive, you know, they are very understanding. So that has been a great blessing.
Do you think, when we talk about women empowerment, do you think it's important that women also empower women?
Definitely. Because right now there are more girls entering universities, But in, you get only 35% working in the formal sector. That's because, you know, the majority of the women, although they are qualified, they give priority to their family obligations. In Sri Lanka, we don't have this working system of working from home, working, you know, flexi hours. So some are forced to leave their jobs. And also there's a culture where women also look down upon women,
right.
Some, but I think it's changing. But what I always request to women who are successful, who are at the top, is to support another woman.
Right.
You know, because if we empower one another, if we support one another, we can, you know,
face
all these obstacles because we are stronger then. So therefore, we need the support of women and also men. There are a lot of men out there who are very supportive of women,
right.
who have been voicing that there should be more women in parliament and the provincial levels. So we have to look at them also. They also have to, because talking only to women will not solve our problems, because it's mainly the men, some men who are obstructing our, you know, future pathway. So we have to get the support of men as well as women, and also women, empowered women should definitely support other women there. And also the girl, because girl, child, because they are the future generation who will sort of, you know, we should have role models, you know, so that the girl child can look at them and learn to rise up in the ladder.
To be inspired.
Yeah.
So when you look back at your political career, what do you think you have been able to contribute to the people you serve?
Of course, I'm very happy. During my first tenure, I was able to renovate all the maternal and child health clinics in my electorate, because that was my specialty. And earlier we had very sort of, you know, very bad shaped small rooms where the mothers, expectant mothers, did not have even the basic facilities. Sometimes even they didn't have even toilet facilities. But right now, all the clinics have been upgraded to the standard of private clinic. And I was also able to build a new MOH office to Sidhu. Normally, for one AGA division, you have only one MOH office, but my electorate has three MOH offices. I was able to build a new one out there. And I was also able to upgrade four schools as Mahindo, their, you know, laboratory language laboratory schools. And then the major challenge, major success was in the water projects. Katan, my husband had a major, you know, aim to provide drinking water to the people of Katana, but he could not. He started a project in 2000, allocated funds, but with the change of government, that project was cancelled. So in 2009, before I became a member of parliament, I was able to, with the support of the then state minister for water, Honorable Mahinda Amaravira, I was able to provide water to say about 8 to 10 Gramanidhara divisions.
Right.
And then once I was elected to parliament in 2010 with under His Excellency Mahinda Rajapaksa's government, Honorable Dinesh Gunawardene as the Minister of Water Supply helped me to provide water to the entire urban council area in Sidhuwa Katunayaka. And we had a balance 45 Gramanidhara divisions, who had, you know, of the 45, about 30 had major difficulties in getting water. So right now the Katana water project is almost, you know, completed. The pipe laying, the towers are in the final stages. So within the next 3 to 4 months, I know the people in my electorate will get drinking water for the entire 24 hours.
That is amazing. And lastly, as a woman, as a parliamentarian, as a mother and as a doctor, what message would you like to share with our viewers, with all the women who are watching this?
Always support another woman. Don't put down a woman, because as a woman, it is our responsibility to empower another woman. So support women.
Thank you so much. That was a wonderful conversation with Dr. Fernandopulle. We have concluded the first segment, but now we actually come to the rapid fire round. Who is the most inspirational politician in the world?
It's a very difficult question. Of course, the previous president of USA, Barack Obama, and also Julia Gillard of Australia.
Favorite female politician?
In Sri Lanka.
Anywhere. No one? Okay. What is your hobby?
I like gardening.
What is your best memory?
The last trip I had with my late husband and family.
If you could be remembered as anything, what would it be?
A woman who has advocated for women.
What was the best day of your life?
The day I got my daughter.
Favorite travel destination?
Australia.
Favorite book?
90 minutes at Entebbe.
Favorite song?
Rattaranduve.
Where do you see yourself in the next 10 years?
Next 5 years, of course, I hope to be in Parliament, promoting more women into politics. And thereafter, I may retire. It depends on the need. If I am required by the country for any services, I will be there.
Okay. Last question. Do you prefer being a doctor or a politician?
A doctor.
Well, I didn't expect that. We have come to the end of an inspiring and empowering conversation. Thank you so much, Dr. Fernandopulle, for being a part of today's segment.
It's a pleasure. Thank you very much, Alanki, for giving me this opportunity.
I wish you all the best. Good luck. And I hope you continue to empower more women.
Thank you.
We have come to the end of the segment. I will be back again with another episode with another inspiring personality. Until then, take care and do not forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel.